My e-paper weather display finally ran out of juice a few weeks ago. In total, the 1000 mAh battery lasted almost exactly 2 months. This would probably have been considerably longer if my home Wi-Fi was a bit more robust. The e-paper weather display achieves its long battery life by going into deep sleep for most of the time and only waking up every 30 minutes to connect to the internet and update the display. This is a pretty interesting and powerful aspect of the ESP32, and I think it deserves a deep dive. So, what are we going to cover in this video? We'll start off with a quick overview of how to get the ESP32 into deep sleep. We'll then cover the ways that the ESP32 can be woken up. We can use a timer to wake up after some time. We can wake up using a single GPIO pin or multiple GPIO pins. And we can wake up using the touch sensors. We'll then cover the code that is required to know why the ESP32 was woken up. And finally, we'll talk about how to maintain state when going into deep sleep. Now, there is another way of waking the ESP32 device up, which uses the ultra-low power coprocessor. But this deserves a deep dive all to itself. So there'll be another video coming soon where we cover that in detail. So don't forget to subscribe. But first, a quick word from the channel sponsor PCBWay. They've been sponsoring the channel for a while now, and we've built a few PCBs with them. We'll be making some more PCBs in some future videos as I want to learn a bit more about KiCad. They also do 3D printing and CNC work. Check out the link to PCBWay in the description. So how do we put the ESP32 into deep sleep? We just need a single function call, ESP deep sleep start. Now, just make sure you have set up some kind of trigger to wake the device up, or you won't wake up until you reset the device. Setting up a timer to wake the ESP32 is very simple. We just call ESP sleep enable timer wake up before we go into deep sleep. This takes one argument, which is the amount of time in microseconds that we want to sleep. Although this is specified in microseconds, the exact resolution depends on the source for the RTC slow clock, which is normally only 150 kHz, so don't expect this to be super accurate. Once we've set up the timer, we just call ESP deep sleep start. It's important to remember that nothing runs after this call, so don't put any code after it. It's also important to remember that before entering deep sleep, you should make sure you put any external peripherals you are using into power saving mode or turn them off. You should also shut down the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth peripherals if you are using them. This demo will sleep for 30 seconds. I've set up the sketch to trigger deep sleep when we push the built-in button. After 30 seconds has passed, the device automatically wakes up and runs our setup function. The next method we'll use for waking up the ESP32 uses the external wake-up mode. This lets us wake up the device when the RTC GPIOs are in a particular state. Note that not all the GPIO pins are wired up to the RTC module. These are the pins that can be used to wake up the ESP32. Now, there are two different options for using GPIO pins for wake-up. We can use a single GPIO pin using the ESP sleep enable EXT0 wake up, or we can use multiple pins using the ESP sleep enable EXT1 wake up. You can configure pull up and pull down resistors using the RTC GPIO pull up and RTC GPIO pull down enable on the pins, but I find it a bit simpler to configure the pin as you would normally and then use the RTC GPIO hold enable functions. These will maintain the pin configuration when going into deep sleep. For ESP sleep enable EXT0 wake up, you specify the GPIO pin that you want to monitor and the logic level you are triggering on. We can test this out using the built-in button on the TTGO. This button connects GPIO 35 to ground, so we need an internal pull-up resistor, and we want to trigger the wake up when the pin goes low. Once again, we go into deep sleep, and then when we push the button, we wake up. To monitor multiple GPIO pins, we use the ESP sleep enable EXT1 wake up function. This lets us specify multiple GPIO pins using a bit mask. We can choose to wake up when any of the pins go high, or we can wake up when all the pins are low. Here I'm setting up the pull down resistor on 2 pins and then configuring the wake up to trigger if any of the pins go high. Once again, we go into deep sleep, and now if any of the pins go high, we wake up. We can also work out which pin woke us up. This is really handy if you have multiple buttons and you want the device to respond in different ways depending on which button is pushed in deep sleep. If we want to wait for all the pins to go low, then set up internal pull-up resistors to pull them all high, and then change the trigger to all low. Once again, we enter deep sleep. Now we only wake up if all the pins are taken low. One interesting point is that you can't really tell which pin actually woke the device up. It will always tell you the lowest GPIO pin was responsible. The final simple thing we can do is wake up using one of the touch pins. There are 9 pins that can be configured to receive touch input. To make wake up from touch work, we need to first set up an interrupt on the touchpad. The interrupt handler can be left empty. We then call the ESP sleep enabled touchpad wake up before entering deep sleep. You can set up multiple touchpads, and any touchpad that has an interrupt attached to it will trigger the device to wake up. To get a sensible value for the threshold, you can experiment using the touch read function to see what values you get when the pins are touched. Once again, we go into deep sleep, and now when I touch the cable, the ESP32 wakes up. So that's it for the simple wake-up modes of the ESP32. As I said earlier, we'll cover using the ultra-low power coprocessor in a follow-up video. As you've seen in the demos, I'm able to show the reason the ESP32 woke up, along with the GPIO pins that caused the wake-up. This is what makes deep sleep mode so powerful. We can go to sleep, and then wake up and respond to user input. It's really simple to get the wake-up calls. We just call ESP sleep get wake-up calls. This will either give us undefined, which in my case I've treated as a normal boot up after a reset or power down. We also get EXT0, EXT1, timer, touchpad, and ULP. As I said earlier, we'll cover the ULP in a later video. With EXT0, we know which GPIO pin caused the wake up, as we can only use one GPIO pin. For EXT1, we can query which GPIO pin caused the wake-up to happen by using ESP sleep get EXT1 wake-up status. This returns a bit mask indicating which GPIO pin caused the wake-up. But note, this is only useful if we are using the any pin high mode. If we are using the wake-up when all pins are low, we don't get any usable information. For touch, we can call the ESP sleep get touchpad wake-up status. This returns a touchpad that caused the device to wake up. Now, this is all pretty cool. But deep sleep turns everything off, including the RAM that your program is using to store variables. Everything gets lost when you go into deep sleep mode. How do we solve this problem? Going back to our original block diagram, we can see that there is some memory associated with the RTC module. This memory is kept alive when we go into deep sleep. We have 16 kilobytes of RTC memory. We can store data in this memory by using the RTC data attribute flag. You can store basic types and even structures in this memory by using this flag. One thing to be aware of is this memory will persist during deep sleep, but it won't persist if power is removed or the reset button is pushed. If you want persistent state between power and reset cycles, then you need to write your data to flash or some external persistent storage such as an SD card. How much power can we actually save by going into deep sleep? Now, I don't really have the right equipment for measuring low current usage, but the guy with the Swiss accent has done some really great videos measuring the deep sleep current of various different dev boards. I've linked to one of his videos in the description, and you can get a link to this spreadsheet that shows a variety of boards along with their deep sleep currents. I've done a quick test with my TTGO display board. I'm measuring the voltage drop over a 10 ohm resistor, so this is showing about 60 to 80 milliamps in normal mode. When we drop down to deep sleep, this drops to less than a milliamp. As you can tell from the spreadsheet, you can get much lower than this with the right hardware and by powering down all the peripherals. Some boards go down to tens of microamps. It's pretty amazing stuff. I've got a project coming soon that will make use of deep sleep, so stay tuned, and I'll see you in the next video.